Okay, here we go. Welcome to TM Broadcasting. We are coming to you live from Boston, Massachusetts. My name is Frank Allen. Today's date is 5-6-22. Tonight, Sasha and I have the great pleasure of interviewing Melanie Rishon and Alison Smith and Amy from Amy's Audio. And it should be a very interesting evening tonight. If you'd like to call in and listen, the phone number is +1-518-801-1318. If you have a question for anyone, please dial 1-617-987-8603. Okay, let's see what we can talk about here and open things up a little bit. I know we have heard a lot from Amy, and everybody is talking about Amy, actually, and Amy's Audio, and all the work that she has been doing for the community. And checking out signals, checking people out, checking their recordings. It's fantastic. Amy, would you like to go ahead?
Sure. Thank you, Frank. I appreciate that. A little bit about what I do is, he did mention I do the audio analysis for victims that are being electronically harassed and tortured. They also have energy weapons, directed energy weapons, and different air-to-air missile defense systems that are attacking their body as well. So basically what I do is I take a video, a phone conversation, or an audio file that the victim has recorded, and I analyze it, and I'm actually able to capture subliminal embedded telecommunications because they're using your phones and your devices, microphones, and video components, and tapping into them, their network information gets captured into those recordings. So that's one thing that I do for the community and help out. Another one is I've been doing thermal imaging scans. I'm able to identify the weapon systems and the attacks on your body, even with the neurological links as well, because they send electrical shocks through your body too. So I do thermal scans and forensic photos. I take photos of the wounds, and then I take thermal imaging, which the thermal imaging verifies the microwave radiation, the electromagnetic radiation, and the microwave radiation within those photographs. And then with the audio analysis, the information and the locations on the body that they're attacking you with that I hear from the criminals themselves, line up with the body photos and the thermal images attacks as well. So that's another thing that I've been working on for the community and adding that into my repertoire of things that I'm helping out the community. I also do FCC identification database systems as well. With the subliminal acoustics, I'm able to identify all the radio frequencies, and there are only radio frequencies and telecommunications within that file as well. And I could actually pull up that information and do an FCC database search to find out who owns those signals and where they may be coming from. Yes. Wow.
I'm sorry. I am so impressed. I had to speak. Oh, my God. It's amazing. Wow.
Thank you, Sasha.
Yeah. So,
those are just a couple of things that I've been doing as well. I also finally paid off of my patent for the victims in the community, for everybody in the world as well. You guys will be able to download and live stream and capture their communications in real time.
Wow, great.
And you guys will be able to prove the attacks on your body systems as well as get the spectrum information and the network information and find out and do pings, locations, and tags and gather information on your criminals. So it should be released by the end of the year. I think I only have $185 left on it. I'm really excited about that. I'm going to call next week and make my final payment. So they've been working on it for the last 4 years, and I believe they said it should take 3 to 6 months to be released afterward. So we're finalizing the project, and I'm getting really excited to help everybody here.
Well, that's fantastic. You've come a long way in a very short time. I was just curious. You use thermal imaging. What are you seeing when there is an attack? I mean, what do you see? Have you had the opportunity to actually film when there is an attack, or are you just seeing the location of the attack?
I'm just seeing it on the victim's body, their residual marks from it. They align perfectly with the nerves and the central nervous system. And depending on where they're attacking you, because these criminals actually can aim the equipment to very specific spots and locations of your body. They could even hit your veins. They could hit your nervous system. They could hit either go down to the molecular level and hit your atoms and nucleuses. They could destroy them from the inside, depending on the equipment that they're using, obviously. Your bones, and they leave small residual circular marks on your body. A lot of them can't be seen on the normal eye. That's why the thermal imaging, but you have to make sure that you are using the thermal imager appropriately.
Okay.
And that means you have to lower your body heat and your temperature first. So,
okay, we all understand and we all know that the brain operates in the low hertz range, anywhere from 0.1 hertz on up, we'll say, to active areas around 100 hertz and up. What are you actually measuring? Are you measuring heterodyning, which is actually a piggyback affair where the one signal is piggybacked on another? I realize you have a patent and you have procedures that are yours alone, but I was just curious as to how much you could share and recommend. I know that the Blue Mouse is the best microphone in the world today for recording things such as internal body activity, in this case, V2K. It used to be rented out. I believe it was $1,200 to rent it. Now, it could be a lot less expensive today, and there may even be a better product. Do you want to expand on that?
Okay, well, with the microphone systems, understanding that it's the best microphone in the world, it doesn't matter what type, because these are actually subcarrier frequencies and subcarrier telecommunications. So when you're dealing with radio frequencies, they could be transmitted from multiple different uses. So it doesn't matter how or what level or range the V2K is in. It's how it's being transmitted and transported, and that the equipment that they use, along with subwoofers, right? So the subwoofers, when it comes out of their system, subwoofers are unable to be captured from the naked ear. If you hear somebody recording a loud bass sound, right, like boom, 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 and you record it, you cannot hear those loud booms in that recording or that file. Why? Because they're sub-level, which is why it's called a subwoofer. So the sub-carriers' communications, they just get entrapped, and it's just how you process the audio file to bring them up to an audible level. So the subcarrier waves could be used anything from video stream transmissions. It could be coming from Zigbee ambient. It could come from different locations like ambient power, BLE networks, 2.4, 5G. It all depends on the device and the capabilities of where they're transmitting these communications from. So when you say a specific level, they have access to every frequency range. So if one doesn't work, they're just going to find another channel or bandwidth that they could access and use it against the victim.
I see. Okay, go ahead. Did you have something you wanted to say, Sasha? Or no?
No, I was. I'm completely with you in this second, and I would like you to carry on speaking. I do have a question for you, but it's related to something else.
Okay, Amy, I was also curious as to your opinion on different opinions, actually. It is my opinion, and I say opinion, that these attacks are brought on to the head. And can you elaborate on that and tell us why you feel that these attacks are not to the head?
Well, I never said they're not through the head. They're usually through the cochlear and vestibular system. The noises and the transmitting. It just depends on the victim itself, because not everybody is the same way. Some do have chips and sensors inside their body. Some are harassed and have graphene. Some have the nanotech inside. So depending on how they're accessing, somebody have chips and implants. They use different types of tone generators to connect to the brain. Obviously, they use a basic G actually to make those connections. That note, that key signature is what gives them open access into your body and your mainframe. Depending on the military status, each victim has a file that the DOD and the FBI give out to these criminals, and they're able to access it from those lists. So it depends on the victim. Neurologically, there's different medical software and equipment that they have that can access your body. They could use a wireless personal area network. They could do a personal area network as well. It just depends on how they're gaining access. And a lot of the victims are different. But mainly, I am always finding it through chip implants behind the ears through the cochlea. And the BCI technology, the artificial intelligence, the synthetic telepathy, their microphone systems, that software is embedded into their quantum computers. And yes, they do have quantum computer systems that are using this. I do have the audio evidence to verify that, along with the type of computer systems and Linux operating systems that they're using and have installed onto it as well. So a lot of that has to deal with the technology and the installation from their computer systems, along with directional antenna systems.
Okay, Sasha, I know that you're one of Amy's admirers.
Yeah.
Along with Alison, and we'll let Alison go next. Would you like to ask Amy some questions?
I would. Amy, I was wondering about what kind of sound files you need to decipher. Say you were doing the history of my life. Could I use recorded music that was professionally recorded? Or I don't have. I've got like really voice diaries that I've been keeping throughout my trials over the last 3 years on this one device. And I was wondering if you could, I managed to catch two perps when they came into my friend's restaurant to humiliate me yesterday. And the guy sitting next to me, his voice is dominant. Could you isolate him and concentrate on them, for example?
Absolutely. I would just need to know what his voice sounds like so I know how to identify or who I'm identifying in that file. Like, that has to deal with voice comparisons, right? So we would be able to do that if I had a voice comparison to review the file from. Now, but with a lot of victims, isolating it, some of the victims only have 4 or 5 people on there. Some of the victims also have a network of 498 people connected to them, too. So each one victim is different than others. As for the sound files, any sound file can be used. I've got Allison's spy USB pen that I'm analyzing. SD cards, different formats from the Ring system, security Ring camera systems. Any security cameras capture audio files as well. Your phone, your laptop, your iPad, computer. I've tested it with multiple different types of applications and recording applications, different softwares you could download from either the apps from the store, Google Play Store, or personal software that you purchased. So every single, I can't say every single one because I haven't, there's over 10 million in the world, but I have not come across one type of file from people recording that I'm not able to capture them. If you're not a victim, these communications are not in there. They're blank. There's no sound. It's complete nothing. Static. Only victims have these communications in the background of it.
Wow. Well, I can't wait to engage with you and do it. I'm so excited. It's given me hope. I didn't know about your work, Amy. I had heard other people in our community. I've only been on the calls here for a couple of months, really. And Lizzie was speaking about how well you'd have held space. I think you did a presentation recently, didn't you, a couple of months ago?
Yes, I have. Yeah.
Yeah. What was that presentation on?
The presentation was for the ICATOR lawsuit and the lawyer associations.
Okay. And was that to the UN? Did you do it to the UN? No.
I did submit that separately. That was a couple of years ago, I believe. They actually wanted only a 2,000 word. I sent them in a 60-page document. I got more to say than 2,000 words, along with the PowerPoint presentation and audio verifications as well. embedded into that PowerPoint. So I was never recognized for that. So I'm unaware if they ever received it or not. But I did know that I did get the email confirmation that my items were set.
Well, that's great. I mean, I've actually written that down today as one of the things that I find so upsetting from the past of what it was like being in this program and trying to reach out for help, falling between two different categories of law, family and criminal, and then going to human rights like Amnesty. And they said, oh, no, sorry, we don't help people from Europe, only from the continent. And I was like, well, okay. What are we supposed to do when our human rights are taken away from us? And she didn't have the answer to that. And I just think that it's, not to knock the UN, but it's so faceless. It's got, you've got all of those email addresses and there's no interface or response back. I think it's, yeah, deeply tragic because we all need hope. And you speaking to me makes me feel hopeful, you know, that we can collect indefatigable evidence and move forward at a pace, do you know?
Yeah, I understand. Thank you. That makes me feel so good. It's good to hear that I'm bringing hope to the community, and that's what we need as the victims of these crimes, is to bring that hope, to make people step forward out of their shell, to work for an achievement, a goal, to pass legislations, to pass bills, to get these laws. That's why the ICATOR lawsuit is so important, because providing that evidence and letting the Belgium government see the abuse that they are doing on their citizens, and not only citizens across the world on a global scale, going after these companies and big tech corporations, I'm very proud to be part of that ICATOR lawsuit.
Absolutely. And I am so relieved that that everything is moving forward to that objective, you know, thank God. I had another question here and I've just lost it. Frank, can you step in for a minute? I've got whiteout in my brain.
not a problem. No, we experience that from time to time.
Yeah.
You can be sitting there and the V2K will say, well, I'm going to start stepping on his short-term memory. And they do. And they can take a sentence, a word, or a complete idea or thought, if you will, from you. Not permanently. They can't blank you out forever. I believe, and this is a belief of my own, they are physically, I believe, once again, using our own aura against us. And I think they are picking up signals from the very surface of our skin out to quite some distance, as some people have testified over the years, where the aura can actually go. Do you have any comments on that?
Any? But do you, because the energetic field is all vibration. Every cell within every organ within our body has a different frequency. And of course, you know, like sometimes I hadn't contemplated that. I've worked with technology that allows the human aura to be seen from a photographic point of view and from a healing point of view, using scalar waves when they're used to their best effect, not when they're used to torture and burn us. But because of my experience, I found that I'm such a spiritual person, and I know about some of the manifestations of that in my energetic body, but it would seem that they're not interested in that at all. They just seem more hell-bent on destroying. But, yeah, I suppose it makes perfect sense that they would use the energetic field to make a hole in it, to use it to take away your confidence, all sorts of different things, you know? makes complete sense to me, but I hadn't fully comprehended it. And I hadn't considered that the technology that they were using, like multi-spectrum or spectral analyzers, you know, I even though I've worked with the technology, I can't remember specifically what it was.
Okay. His name. It's, oh, okay, I'm sorry. Would you like to speak, Alison?
I think I've got white out brain right now as well.
it happens.
Do I want to speak? Yeah, I'll go on then. Okay. The first thing, if you don't mind, I'd just like to say is I'd just like to pass along my apologies from Melanie. She's had some urgent thing and she can't attend today. So I do apologise, but I'm here. So I can go through some updates. That was what the point of us very kindly being allowed on your show was about, was to go through some updates regarding the lawsuit and our current position. Is that okay?
That's absolutely fine, sure.
Right, okay. So we're at a point where, and I did say this the other day, so we're at a point where we need to show that all efforts outside of the courtroom have been exhausted. With any class action, they will expect everything to have been tried to resolve the crime or dispute within common law. So we're going through two phases. We have been mentioning quite a bit recently about a petition which is now underway, and it should be online for anyone to sign during the month of May, hopefully by towards the end of May. We require 25,000 signatures for the petition. The reason we held the recent conference via our lawyers' association was because they have between 60 and 80,000 followers, and a lot of them are going to aid in signing the petition. It was also to raise awareness because the lawyers are putting the case forward as public interest, which is fantastic. It's going to get, it's going to raise a lot of awareness around the world, we hope. We're doing the petition. The lawyer, the head lawyer, whose name is Paolo, he is going to be drafting up a document to go along with that. And this petition and the document will go to the Belgian Parliament requesting immediate regulation upon the weapon systems being used on Belgian territory. Now, we can't have them banned, but we can have them regulated. So that's the main phase we're at now. There will also be, as a part of this, sort of preparation or pre-trial hearing. We will be selecting a number of victims. They will mainly be from Belgium, with it being a Belgium-based case, but we will select a few others from other parts of the world to, for lack of a better way or better phrase, show the scope of the matter. So that's the first phase. The second phase will be a penal law procedure where we will be basing it upon irrefutable evidence. So again, we'll select a number of victims who have sound evidence, and they will be in a courtroom and they will testify. An investigating judge will be appointed, and said judge will appoint a medical expert to review the evidence. And we will request to try and condemn offenders and for the state to pay damages. And for these two phases, we do need to do a little bit more fundraising. And I have recently updated the website. So all this information is now on the ICATOR website, which is www.icator.be. So those are the main updates. As soon as the petition is online, we ask if every victim possible and who is willing, if they could kindly sign the petition. That should be up online towards the end of May. And the other thing is that on the 10th of May, between 8 p.m. and 10 p.m. Belgium time, we have arranged a meeting with the lawyers. It's a Zoom meeting. It's free for all ICATOR members and any other victims from around the world to join, in which case they can listen and hear how the lawsuit will be put forward, and we'll be able to ask the lawyer any questions that they wish to do so. So I have recently, yesterday, done a mail merger out to a hell of a lot of people regarding this with the link. It's up on the ICATOR website. It's up on Peacepink. It's up on Targeted Survivors, Twitter and LinkedIn. we hope as many people as possible can tune into that so that they can hear how things are going to be dealt with and ask any questions. And we hope that those that can, because we do understand that victims have financial difficulty a lot of the time, but those that can, if they can kindly help with donations, every little bit helps. So those are the main updates, and I would be happy to do my best to answer any questions that anybody has during the show.
Thank you, Alison. I had a quick question. How did you find Paolo to have trust that he would be brave enough and honourable enough to honour us in the fight? I'm going to use the term us. I hope that's okay.
Yeah, of course it is, yeah. Okay, so a prior ICATOR board member, he's no longer a board member, and I don't know him very well myself, so I won't use his name right now because I'm not sure if I should do. But he's actually friends with our head lawyer, Paolo. He's known him for some time, and we are very lucky to have him because we all know that finding a lawyer to take on some kind, you know, a case of this magnitude and this content is just, you know, so difficult.
Yeah,
so an ex-board member knows him and he's taken on the case. And I flew over to Belgium last year in last September, and I was going to attend the ICATOR scanning. What I didn't know was that I'd end up going to a meeting in person with the lawyer and the other people that were being scanned. Well, a few of them anyway. So, yeah, I got the chance to meet him, and I can definitely tell that he's taking this so very, very seriously. At the recent conference we held, we had a psychotronic and microwave weapons expert speaking, whose name is Daniel Dupree. He has been taking on cases like this and has been the chair for a lot of environmental and electronics and radio frequency sort of, I don't know, governing bodies. There's information about him on the ICATOR website. But when Danielle Dupree, Depris.
I began to give up hope that there were any lawyers like this in the world. I got turned away from so many lawyers, you know, just heartbreaking.
Yeah, I know. I know the feeling. I spoke to Barry Trower at length about how I could take my attackers to court here in the UK, and it's just not ever going to happen. I'll need a good quarter of a million in the bank, and it's just not going to happen. So I feel lucky to be a part of the ICATOR lawsuit.
All of these lawyers are from Belgium, or they're European people?
Well, they're French or from Belgium. The language used in Belgium is French. So basically, it was just him to begin with. And then really sort of luckily in brilliant timing, he was appointed the vice president of this association, which is Droits Libertaires. That means rights and freedoms. So we now have several lawyers at our disposal. And it was at that time when he decided to change the case to a public interest case, which is superb. It really is superb. But during that conference, when Danielle Dupree was speaking, our lawyer was asking him questions. And I'm telling you, he's taking this so very seriously. It was his idea to hold a conference via their own website as well. So we are very lucky to have him on side. We really are. Yeah.
Wow, that's fantastic. I was just contemplating, because governments are so slippery by nature, how the government could potentially be in a position where they would have to pay out to the citizens of Belgium for the damage that they've sustained in their life.
Well, it depends on how things go. The lawyers right now are still deciding on whether the case should be civil, criminal, or both. This is one of the most important decisions that needs to be made. It really is crucial. They're also looking into ways in which we could be compensated. And at this time, it is going to be the Belgian government being prosecuted for not protecting citizens. That's the best way to go forward with this. Right now, we don't know, we cannot say who or what department of the government it will be, because we're not at that stage yet. But the lawyers have sat with Melanie for a long, long time before she has gone forward with anything, to figure out the best possible way of doing this, where it's not going to just get thrown out, where it's going to be taken seriously. And